or people, learn me and attend to you. For I know not whether after this year I shall be ever amongst you again. Therefore, listen to what I'm saying to you very carefully, and take these words to those who could not be present here today. O people, just as you regard this month, this day, this city as sacred, so regard the life and property of every Muslim as a sacred trust. Return the goods entrusted to you to the rightful owners. Help no one so that no one may hurt you. Remember that you will indeed meet your Lord, and that he will indeed reckon your deeds. Allah has forbidden you to take usury, interest. Therefore, all interest obligations shall henceforth be waived. Your capital, however, is yours to keep. You will neither inflict nor suffer any iniquity. Allah has judged that there shall be no interest, and that all the interest due to Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, the Prophet's uncle, shall henceforth be waived. Beware of Shaitan, beware of Satan, for the safety of your religion. He has lost all hope that he will ever be able to lead you to astray in big things. So be aware of following him in small things. O people, it is true that you have certain rights with regards to your women, but they also have rights over you. Remember that you have taken them as your wives only under Allah's trust and with his permission. If they abide by your right, then to them belongs the right to be fed and clothed in kindness. Do treat your women well, and be kind to them, for they are partners and committed helpers. And it is your right that they do not make friends with anyone whom you do not approve, as well as never to be unchaste. O people, listen to me in earnest. Worship Allah, say your 5 daily prayers, Salah, fast in the month of Ramadan, and give your wealth in Zakah, perform your Hajj if you can afford to. Remember, all mankind is from Adam and Eve. An Arab has no superiority over a non-Arab. A non-Arab has no superiority over an Arab. Also, a white has no preference over a black, nor a black has any superiority over white, except by piety with good action. Learn that every Muslim is a brother to every Muslim, and that the Muslim constitute one brotherhood. Nothing shall be legitimate to a Muslim which belongs to a fellow Muslim, unless it was given freely and willingly. Do not therefore do injustice to yourselves. Remember, one day you will appear before Allah. Remember, one day you will appear before Allah and answer your deeds. So be aware, do not stray from the path of righteousness after I am gone. O people, no prophet or apostle will come after me, and no new faith will be born. Reason well, therefore, O people, and understand words which I convey to you. I leave behind me two things, the Quran and my example, the Sunnah, and if you follow these, you will never go astray. All those who listen to me shall pass on my words to others, and those to others again, and may the last one who understand my words better than those who listen to me directly. Be my witness, O Allah. Be my witness, O Allah, that I have conveyed your message to your people. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then, basically he pointed his index finger towards the heaven and said, Allahumma ashhad, Allahumma ashhad, Allahumma ashhad, and the adhan was called, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then he led salah. Now a couple of points here. The scholars have mentioned that this khutbah was heard by 120,000. 120,000, when the Prophet was speaking, he never had a microphone. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was speaking, the last person heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was a miracle. Even the last person heard it. When the Prophet of Allah spoke sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it mentioned by the scholars in the books of Sirah that they said that futihat adhanuna, our ears were made to listen. We could hear the words coming to us, although they were far away. And inshallah ta'ala, on our ziyarah day, we will go to Masjid Namira and other places. You will see, if everyone gathers there, the last person to hear is not possible. But it's possible because the Prophet of Allah is delivering the khutbah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Secondly, what else happened there, another opinion was that, you know, they passed the message on. Okay, so the first people, they were telling everyone, and everyone was asking what the Prophet of Allah said, and everyone, they memorized it. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, that make sure, أَلَا فَلْيُبَلِّغْ أَشَّاهِدْ مِنْكُمْ الْغَائِبْ, those of you are present here, take my words. From this, the Sahaba, they have understood that they have to memorize the hadith. So the Sahaba, they memorized the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today, you would not find a biography of any any person in such detail than the Prophet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, everything he has done is mentioned in our books. Take for example, a very simple surah of the Quran, Bidayah al-Nihaya, an extract from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He mentioned everything in the chain of transmission. Another book called Zad al-Ma'ad, written by Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala. He mentioned all the ibadat of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how he prayed, how he walked, how he talked, what do you do. Take another book, for example, Al-Khasa'is al-Qudra for Imam al-Suyuti rahimahullah. He talks about the special characteristic of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that no other prophet shared, something unique about him. Take another example of Rasulullah, another seerah book. For example, the seerah book was very popular. It's called Shama'il al-Tirmidhi. Imam al-Tirmidhi goes Shama'il. In the Shama'il al-Tirmidhi, he mentioned about the prophet's appearance sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how he looked, how big was his hair, how long was the hair, his nose size, his ears, his the prophet's appearance, how tall was he, the Shama'il, his characteristics. Everything, and there are many other seerah books, I'm just mentioning some. They've recorded every single thing. And the Sahaba, when they narrated hadith, they don't say the Prophet of Allah said, they said, I was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I was behind him. I was in the camel. Why did they say that for? They want to draw a picture for you. Okay? I was with him. And he said, oh, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he smiled so beautifully that I saw, the whole of the teeth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I saw his gums, another Sahabi says. I saw the front two molars, another Sahabi says. Why did they say all that? Because the Ummah will be coming later on. They need to know about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay, and if you carry on, another Sahabi said that, I saw the Prophet of Allah making dua in istisqa for asking for rain. He said, did you, and then he explained, he raised his hand so beautifully, because the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wearing, you know, something like that. And he said, he raised his hand so high, I saw the beautiful whiteness of his armpits, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These kind of details being preserved so that we could learn from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are the sunnah brothers, studying the hadith and looking at the characteristics, his conduct, his manners, and putting them into practice. This is the true number of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Moving on, let's look at some of the important points here. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, obviously, he stressed a couple of things here. Number one, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talked about the first thing, he talked about the sanctity of human beings' life. What a beautiful thing, at a time when people are killing each other. Look what's happening in Syria. Look what's happening in Iraq. Look what's happening in Palestine, and happened for 60 years now, and other places. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam very beautifully talked about the sanctity of life. In Arabia itself, you know, in Arabia itself, there's a battle called Harb al-Basus. Okay, and you know, when we study Arabic language, they taught us another poetry. A poet goes, لَوْ كُنْتُ مِنْ نَازِلٍ لَمْ تَسْتَبِحْ إِبْنِي بَلُوا لَقِيْتَةٍ مِنْ جُبْلِ بْنَ شَيْبَانَ إِذَنْ لَقَامَ بِنَصْرِ مَعْشَرٍ خُشُنٌ عِنْدَ الْحَفِيظَةِ إِنْ ذُو لُوثَةٍ لَانَ. In poetry, he goes that if I was from this tribe, then my camel would not be snatched away. The story of Harb al-Basus was that a man, basically, there's actually many other poems anyway, but I'm just choosing few because that's not the time for this. Basically, one tribe's camel went to another tribe, yeah, and they drank water from it. So this person, they said that this camel is not from here, so they slaughtered the camel. The camel's owner went there, because that was my camel. He said, yeah, but you had no right to come into our area. This is camel, it's an animal, I don't control, they killed him as well. So his family went, they killed the other family. And then the both village, they fought each other for 30 years. The Prophet of Allah came and just after that, he was. And this kind of thing is happening in his community. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him the first important thing, that Islam is a religion that gives you life, not to take the life away. So all these people, they say that, you know, Muslim, they love jihad, and, you know, it's a holy war. War is not holy in Arabic. If you look in the classical Arabic language, the meaning of war, and how they explain war in language, in the period they say they were shar, harb, shar, kariha, musiba, naiba. These are the name of the battle. All of them means, shar means evil. They consider fight to be an evil thing. I'm talking about poet before the arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Jahiliyyah poet I'm talking about. I'm talking about those. They consider this to be a dirty thing. They didn't like it. So this, you know, the people have a different agenda. Oh, Muslims, they love killing each other. No! The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came to finish all that off. Okay, secondly, kariha means something that is disliked. Kariha means something that is, so the Arab, they disliked fighting, they didn't like that. Musiba means trials and tribulation and putting yourself into danger. So battles and jihad was never liked. It never liked. Okay, so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came and he said that we need to respect each other human being. So his last teaching was his first teaching. That is that all people, you need to remember that
You cannot hurt a soul. You have to believe in the sanctity of life. Life is sacred. You can't take someone's property away, because that is another problem. People steal, a lot of stealing, and there were lots of highway robbers as well. You can't do that. The Prophet ﷺ came and he demolished that as well, and he said that this is wrong. You cannot take someone else's property except with his own will. The Arabs at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, Ja'far radiallahu anhu, when he went to Abyssinia, and they asked him, the king, the Najashi asked him, what does your prophet tell you to do? What did he say? He explained, he said, look, you know, we were very bad people. Yes, and one of the things he said, Al-Qawiyyu minna ya'kulu da'if. The strong amongst us is to eat the weak ones. People snatching the wealth away. And just because you're rich, just because you've got the money, they were bullying the weak ones. That's something that they were saying that no. You know, this is what the Prophet of Allah came and told us not to do, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then we talked about the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about shirk, and he said in Saudi Arabia, or let's just say in the Jaziratul Arab and in the Arab land, inshallah, they only know shirk. But he said that even the shaitan knows as well that in Mecca and Medina they only know shirk, inshallah ta'ala. Okay, however, remember, shaitan is still around. Okay, so he has obviously lost all the hope that he will ever to lead you to astray in big things, in shirk and etc. But there are small things that he will use you, and he will just be obedient to them. And this is happening, you know, lots of sins. And don't be deluded by looking at just Mecca and Medina. If you go around a little bit more further down and see what's happening in Riyadh and Jeddah and Dammam and all these other places, you will be shocked. Okay, and the Prophet ﷺ prophecy was that this was going to happen. Okay, only thing that you're going to tell people that, oh, we don't worship idols, but there are many other things that you're worshipping, you just don't know it. And that's what the Prophet of Allah ﷺ said this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that understanding. Another thing that he said is about women. The Prophet of Allah ﷺ said that look after them, be nice to them, remember that you have taken them as your wives only with Allah's trust and permission. Do treat your women well and be kind to them. The reason he said that, because that time will come, the Prophet knew ﷺ, that women won't be treated like that. They will be ignored, they will be abandoned, they will be completely, you know, left alone. And, you know, to an extent, this is what's happening in our countries, or we say the Muslim countries. Okay, we have our own understanding of hijab, our understanding of niqab. Hijab and niqab is very important, but they do not mean that they should be abandoned. They also have to have education. You know, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she used to teach. And if you look at many, Karima al-Marwaziyya rahimahullah, she also used to teach. We have so many scholars, hadith scholars, when it comes to women as well. We need to have this kind of hadith scholars. How many women are memorized in the Quran? You'll see very less. How many women are memorized the hadith? You'll find very less. How many women we have in our community that memorized Sahih al-Bukhari? We'll find very less. Women need to be treated that, just like that as well. Their education needs to be looked into as well, and they have to be looked after. Another important message of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was about racism. You know, in the Arab world, as you know, that the problem they had, not only color, it's also other cultural things as well. They should treat the Abyssinians as slaves, and they treated them very badly as well. Bilal was a victim of that, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made Bilal his muadzin. Okay, when Bilal became the muadzin, and he called the adhan, you know, Bilal is the only sahabi, he called adhan in three masjid. Bilal called, the first person to call adhan in the Kaaba was Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Fath Makkah. In Fath Makkah, he called the adhan on the roof of the Kaaba. He climbed the Kaaba, and from the roof of the Kaaba, on the Kaaba, he called the adhan. Bilal radiallahu ta'ala, the books of Sirah mentions. Bilal radiallahu ta'ala is the first person to call the adhan in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina. Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when Umar ibn Khattab went to Palestine, when the keys of Palestine was given to him, when Umar went and he went to Al-Aqsa, Masjid Al-Aqsa, he said, Bilal, you call the adhan. And Bilal called the adhan. Bilal was the first to call adhan in the three sanctified masjid as legislated by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his message was that Islam abolished racism. You don't look at the color or the background or the culture, no. The Prophet said very simply, he finished that, he said, look, kullukum min Adam wa Hawa, every one of you have one father, one mother. We know our color could be different, our language is different, our culture is different, we come from different background, but we all come from Adam, and our mother is Eve. So why are you looking at someone and belittling him? Why are you degrading another Muslim brother or a sister? That is not the way to do it. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam finished that. But why is he mentioning again? He's mentioning again because it might come back again, and I don't need to elaborate if it's back or not. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after that, he said the most strongest message probably of all is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then after him there is no other prophets to come. So he said that, listen to me, He will go through basically a different time, a difficult time, then trial and tribulation. He will go through all that. But if you hold on to two things, then you will never be misguided. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that in his last sermon, and he knows, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that his time is very close for him to go and meet his Lord and go away from this dunya. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, but two things, remember, don't let them go, ever. One is the Book of Allah, the Quran. Hold on to it. Okay? Hold on to the Book of Allah. And, you know, this is, the Quran will guide you. Whenever you're in trouble, the Quran will give you guidance. Whenever you need help, the Quran will, you know, will give you that help. And then he said that, and my sunnah, my traditions, my example, hold on to them. So the sunnah of the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is there so that we look after it, inshallah ta'ala. The Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said this. In another hadith, the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, coming back to the first point, and with this inshallah ta'ala will end, because I can see people are looking at the food now, okay. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, well, the first thing we talked about, that remember, and we talked about the sanctity of human life, that every soul is, is sacred. And the Prophet ﷺ said in another hadith as well, from this you could understand, he said, a time will come. It's one of the hadiths of what we call it, Dala'il al-Nabuwa, toward the end of the time. He said, a time will come when yakthiru al-haraj, there will be a lot of haraj. The Sahaba, they said, Ya Rasulullah, mal haraj. What is haraj, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Qatl, that people will be killing one another. And you will see that everywhere. Remember, when you see that, this is the end of the time. We are in the end of the time. How many years or months left, Allah knows best. Okay? Then another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it's like a sea. This hadith, brothers, you'll see that it's the Prophet of Allah. It's like, you know, he saw it and he told us. He said, Sayati ala al-nas zaman. A time will come when people will be killing one another. La yadri al-qatil fima qatal, wa la yadri al-maqtul fima qutil. The killing will be so dominant that people will be killing each other. The murderer, the killer, he doesn't know why he is killing. He has no idea. And the one who's been killed, he doesn't know that what sin this person has done for it to deserve to be killed. And this is exactly what's happening. Why are they going into town and killing and etc. is happening? Why suddenly a bomb is, you know, children, they just woke up in the morning in Palestine, in Gaza. They wake up in the morning, young children, subhanAllah. I stopped watching all this because it breaks your heart. Young children, they wake up and they're very beautiful, innocent kids. And they're going to school and suddenly a bomb landed and all 20 of them became martyrs. These are young children. This is the hadith. Okay? Why? What did they do? وَلَا الْمَقْتُولُ فِي مَا قُتِلْ. The maqtul doesn't know. Those who were killed, they have no idea why they are killed. And the person who's killing, he's not getting anything out of it as well. Why? He doesn't know. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, but this is what's going to happen. This is exactly what's happening. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we could talk many more. He gave us so many signs of the here towards the end of the time. Respected brothers and elders, one thing that we need to take from Arafah is the love of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes with evidences as well. Come with Sunnah. Come with the lives of the Sahaba. We gotta love the Prophet of Allah the way the Sahaba loved him. That's the love. The Sahaba radiallahu anhu loved Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They followed him in everything that he did. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us that kind of love, inshaAllah ta'ala. And inshaAllah we're going to now pray Salat al-Dhuhr with the Adhan. InshaAllah we're going to pray Dhuhr, and then we're going to pray Asr, and then the food inshaAllah will be served. So those of you who are going to pray Salat al-Dhuhr with us, inshaAllah, is there in your mind, okay? And that is that we're praying 2 rakat Dhuhr.